Let's see what's happening. If anything, one, two. So I am definitely live on Facebook. Okay. So I'm going to put the title card back up, play the music. I wonder why that's not happening on YouTube. Oh, well. Let's try that. Okay. Let's see if anything. Okay. Apparently, there are two streams. On YouTube. Interesting. Ah. Great. Teething problems, first day on the job. Maybe that is to be expected. It does say there is a live masterclass
great.
Going on.
Great. Teething problems, okay. First day on the job.
Also, maybe that is to be expected.
That.
Okay, well, here we go. Seems to be working everywhere. Facebook, YouTube. Let's see if there are comments coming in. Hello. Awesome. Tons of comments. Awesome. All right, so check it out, guys. I am going to close out my windows here so I'm not seeing myself and a whole bunch of things 18 times. Or with the famous delay. And then we can get going. All right, so we go away from there, away from here. Ooh, and we're working. Okay, guys. Let's see if I can get a response on the sound of the bass. That's really important. I want to get that right from the get-go. Make sure it's not blowing anyone's eardrums out. I think the mic is a bit low. Do you mean the vocals or do you mean the bass? We can always have a little more juice on the vocal mic. Aha, 1, 2. Yeah, even that's better in my headphones, so maybe that's better for everyone right now. Okay, yeah, I dropped the link for the redirect into the one link that wasn't working, and we are up and running, I hope. There's obviously a delay a little bit. From when I'm saying something to when you guys are responding. But here we go. Chordal Harmony Masterclass. It is live. Good afternoon, YouTube. Good morning, YouTube. Everyone's vocals are too loud now. Jeez. Okay. Well, you guys have volume control. If they're out of balance, that's one thing. If it's too loud, you can turn it down. So much of my bass, but whoa, maybe too much vocal in the room. So so difficult to balance it for, I don't know how many people are watching right now. Quite a few. I'm really just stalling for time because my fingers are freezing. The beanie is not for show. It's actually cold here, and it's kind of cold in California, which sucks. And these are the first notes of the day. So I am going to start off. If you guys hold your questions for now. If you hold your questions for now, I'm going to start off like 10 or 15 minutes, go over some stuff that I think is super important when it comes to chords. And then Chelsea is going to come down and kind of moderate the questions and kind of feed them to me so I don't have to pay attention to 1,000 things at the same time. And that way everyone's questions hopefully get answered in the order that they were delivered. So I'm sure everyone knows, but just in case you don't, the book, Chordal Harmony, my book, I don't have the physical book to hold here. I have my digital version open, but the book is 50% off. Today is the last day. It's book of the month. That's why we're doing this little live clinic to kind of celebrate that. I'm currently playing the first exercise in Chordal Harmony, and that's kind of how it all starts. There could be debate as to whether we got questions already. Yes, what am I drinking? This in here is an electrolyte powder called Drip Drop mixed with water. My bass is tuned E-A-D-G-C. Somebody says here, Marco Hernandez says, I run my hands in warm water when they're cold before practice. I wish I could do that. Really, I can't get my fingers wet right before I play. It's a real drag. So, I just got to do the old-fashioned warming up with the instrument. So E-A-D-G-C. Yes, this bass is tuned E-A-D-G-C because I have this high C string, low E string. But that doesn't mean all of the concepts I'm about to talk about don't work for however you have your bass tuned. I have a four string sitting right here. Maybe I'll do some stuff on that later. Hey, wear rubber gloves, then use warm water. That is a great idea. Never thought about that. Jane Kavanaugh. Hey, Jane. How do you get such great sound into events like this? Well, if the sound is great for you, that is awesome. That is a happy accident. I will be the first one to admit. Not that the sound isn't great here in the room. It is a happy accident that is actually showing up in this live stream. And yes, I am reading the chat from YouTube. The signal chain right now is it's just out of shot, but I'm using the Noble preamp that goes into the Exotic booster, which is just a little bit more preamp actually, and then my compression pedal, and I have a tiny bit of delay. That's the signal chain right now, So, guys, girls, if you hold the questions for just a minute, because Chelsea's going to come down and moderate them, I'm going to talk a little bit about chordal harmony. That's what this whole thing is about, rather than signal chain and gear. And there's plenty of information about gear out there. So everything is possible on 4-string bass, 5-string bass, 6-string bass, all the stuff I'm going to talk about. All of these chordal exercises. So there's... I don't know why, but people debate, you know, what is a chord? Is a chord something that exists once there's more than one note, or does it have to be three? The technical term for a double stop or two notes is a dyad, right? And then you get three notes is a triad, blah, 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 blah. I think it's all pretty much, it's all kind of pointless discussing that as far as I'm concerned. The way I hear it, the way I feel it is that when there's more than one note, it's a chord. And the foundation, part of the foundation, of course, is the root and the third. So the first exercise in chordal harmony, exercise number one, is simply playing a major scale in tenths. You'd be amazed at the amount of people that, on clinics or whatever, private lessons or something, they've said, oh, I want to play chords and, you know, I really want to get this chord together. Like some complicated, crunchy five-note chord. And I've said, okay, well, let's see if you can play a major scale in tenths up and down the instrument. And can you do that not just in a quote-unquote easy key? Like, I should be looking over here at this mic. Sorry, people. I'll put the little chat window over there as well. Can you do that? Can you also do it in like a little more challenging key, like F sharp or A flat? Can you move it can you move it in half steps and really play just as clean? The answer would be no. I knew I was going to fall flat on my face when I tried to do that. And also, you may notice here on my left hand, I'm using 2 and 3. Can you do it with all four common, all three common, is it 3, 4? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I guess it's 5 combinations. Can you do it with, like, for instance, the third finger and the fourth finger all the way up? And make it sound no different from 1 and 2, for instance. And get into A. And basically, you can see where I'm going with this. How versatile are you? How in control of the fundamentals? How in control of the fundamentals are you? And how, like, I'm talking to you doing this right now, and how, you know, maybe you want to set yourself a challenge of how natural is it? Like, ask yourself, how natural is it? Can you hold a conversation, for instance? Not that I recommend you being distracted when you practice, but there's something to be said for how finding out how deep it is in your muscle memory and just being honest with yourself in the process. How fluidly does it roll off the fingers? You know, just like a second language, how fluidly does it roll off the tongue? Or how much do you have to think like, oh, what is the word is for onion is cebolla? And then, then you have to insert that into a sentence and tienes cebollas, do you have onions? Like, blah, 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 blah. You know, like, how quickly does that roll off the tongue? How second nature is it? David Wraith is asking, why do you hum and play? All right. Again, guys, hold the questions. Otherwise, we'll never get to everything. And when Chelsea comes down to moderate the questions, it will be way slicker. So, really important, being honest with yourself. And that goes with anything, whether it's chordal harmony, whether it's whatever it is. That really doesn't matter. You should really try and be as honest as you possibly can with yourself about how much are you really nailing it, you know? And how much more time could you possibly spend just dialing it in a little more and just making it second nature. I think that's the entire focus right there for me. So I'm always trying to identify that when I have a student or somebody, maybe in a clinic or a masterclass, and they come up and play. I'm always trying to identify, okay, where's that line? Where's that line of comfort? And when does that threshold get met? And when does the thought process start kicking in? Like, oh, and there is Chelsea. our roast master general, Chelsea. She will roast you. Ask stupid questions and Chelsea will roast you. It's not true. I'm just being silly. But yeah, I just asked everyone to hold questions for a minute just while I explain some stuff, basic stuff. I will tell you another it's not a trick. It's not a secret. If you've ever heard me play music, you've heard it and you hear it right now. You hear a little bit of delay on the sound. I'll take it off just to give you the contrast. See how completely dead and dry that is? I just feel that when I kick a little bit of delay on it, it gives it some space. It's a weird thing to say, it gives me some room to move around because I want to be accurate on each iteration of the chord. I don't want to be really moving around very much, but it's a feeling of a little bit more space. Maybe I have to work a little less. Not that the technique changes really, or that I don't have to produce the note as much. Maybe I'm inspired to play less notes and leave more space because there's just a little bit more going on. So that's something I'm really conscious of, you know, when I'm playing lots of chords. Just to give it a little bit more depth. So moving on from that. Fourths, suspensions, just to get a little bit of melodic variation and voice leading ability. And don't forget, we still haven't added a third note. We still haven't even got to triads or triad inversions yet, and we're already like building the ability to play melodically. There's such a huge amount of scope that with just two notes. And then I always reference, you know, a composition by Mike Stern and how effective you can be with writing with just a bass note and a melody note on his tune What Might Have Been. So
All just one melody note and one bass note. So don't ever underestimate the power of the simple side of things. Really, that's why the first two exercises in chordal harmony are just unbelievably important. It's something I still work on, practice, and use all the time, literally every day. Chelsea and I were down here practicing last week, and we were doing some palm muting stuff with chords and just playing. Just working on kind of licks and moving around in the harmony, and it was all based around tense. And all those licks you hear me play when I'm playing grooves like that, tense. There's no mystery. So I just want to highlight the importance of the beginning of the book, and we can get into some questions. Just want to make sure people don't skip over that, because there's so much you can get out of it. And maybe when you see it on the page, you're like, oh, okay, yeah, tense, and it's a major scale. Where's the music? But the music is right. That's it. That's all like G major, tense. Really simple, but you can make music with it. How are you doing with the... You have the questions run in there?
Yeah. Okay. You have them so nicely,
do you know? Yeah, I just... They keep going faster than I can answer them.
Oh.
So if you pull them out,
okay.
You know.
I'm already pulling
okay.
Do you have the first one?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay,
Celio Mota.
Yeah, I should have a microphone.
You should.
Ask, how do you use chordal harmony in a 5-piece band setting?
Wow, how do you use chordal harmony in a 5-piece band setting? As little as possible, I would say. You know, it's really... there's a lot to be said with for taste and for using taste as much as possible. I would say that if you have, especially if that is, you know, if that is like a band with a keyboard player and a guitar player, perhaps you like bass, drums, piano, guitar, and like a lead instrument or a vocalist. Man, that's quite thick and dense already. So you really have to pick your spots. And perhaps if that is a jazz or improvising situation, it's quite common that the rest of the band will drop out and just leave you alone as the bass player. Isn't that a lot of fun, right? So having these options... Having those kind of, you know, self-harmonizing options and those simple things to create motion, especially if it's a one-chord vamp, a little different if you're moving through a bunch of changes. Same concepts apply, but just in terms of creating interest for a bass solo, it could be huge, having the ability to do that and move harmony around the instrument. And then I like to arrange certain things and just, you know, add my kind of... My few signature kind of, you know, chord voicings or into the composition. So that could be a thing as well from a writing standpoint with a 5-piece band, you could use it. But again, I think it's really just about taste and about really picking your moments and not getting in anyone else's way. It's all about making everyone else in the band sound awesome. Yeah. We're trying to stick to chordal harmony. No music philosophy questions today, and unless we run out of chordal harmony questions, which I highly doubt, I'm just trying to keep it focused on this for now because I know a lot of people have questions specifically about chords.
Okay, Michael Mahaffey has a question on something that you already...
Michael Mahaffey, okay, which is... Okay, so great question. Yeah, these guys. So was I playing the half step resolutions or the whole step resolutions, or was I doing it by ear? I wasn't doing any of those things, I don't think, because I was playing diatonically. So sometimes it's a half step resolution, sometimes it's a whole step resolution, just depends where you are in the chord. Yeah, actually, do you want to grab the mic and I can plug you in immediately and you'll be on mic? Yeah. All right. It would make sense if it was that one. Yeah, we're going to get Chelsea a mic here. It's not a massive issue. So sometimes it's a half step. Like if you're in the root position, so if we're in G here, it's the fourth to the third. And then we go up to the next note in the scale. It's A. It's minor, so it's the fifth to the four. Next one is a whole step. Next one is a whole step. Next one is a half step. Whole step, half step. So it just depends where you are diatonically in the scale. And that's only for that particular one. I could play sequentially. You can make so many exercises out of it and do a whole bunch of things. You could stick to one shape moving up in half steps, whole steps, minor thirds. You play atonally, play random, like all kinds of things you can do. But for that particular exercise, which is, I think, exercise two in the book, I should probably know that because I have the book open right here. Chelsea arrives with microphone. We love this. For the purpose of that exercise, it is just diatonic to the chord. Just drop it. There you go. We're going to plug Chelsea into channel two. We would love to plug Chelsea into channel two if it would fit. God, what is going on here? Okay, Chelsea is in channel two. Now let's give her some volume. Yeah, did you bring him down? There you go. Plug it down there. Okay, let's see. Super prepared here at Gwizdala Studios. Let's hear you. There you go. Hello. Interesting. Sorry for the break. Let's see if that works.
Check.
Nope. Well, babe.
Hello. Volume matters.
Okay, there you go. All right, friends, does everyone hear Chelsea now?
Hello.
I hope so.
All right, where were we?
We just did the question on the half step, whole step resolution on exercise one.
Okay, great. Antoine, I'm going to butcher this, Gagné.
Uh-huh.
For the first exercise of the book, do you have any tips to unlock the third and fourth finger? Mine are stuck together.
First exercise of the book? Well, I think that's just a basic technical issue regardless of the first exercise of the book. Actually, something to unstick the third and fourth, was it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there's an exercise, there's a warm-up in the bass player's warm-up, which goes something like this. Ooh, that is really loud. Hang on a second. Because it's just a finger per fret exercise and really expands that third and fourth. It just forces you to have your third and fourth finger open. Move it up in half steps. So it ends up going 2-1, 2-1, 3-4, 2-1, 3-4, 2-1, 3-4, 2-1, 3-4, 2-1, 3-4. And And that just expands. So it's not really about the chordal harmony thing. Yes, of course. What will help you is actually running that exercise with just the third and the fourth finger. That might be a little bit of a shock. You might want to start with one and four. That might feel a little clunky in places and a little cramped, but the wider intervals will feel a little easier. Then kind of expand to two and four. And then wind up to three and four, which is, if your third and fourth finger are a little stuck together, those will probably be the most challenging ones, the 2-4 and the 3-4. But I would expand it like that. And it's just something you have to work on, be conscious of. And yeah, it's not something that happens overnight. Don't rush it. Don't expect to do it for 5 minutes and then be totally fine. Just be in it for the long run, and you'll be cool. Próxima pregunta.
People are saying my mic is panned all the way to the right.
They are?
Yeah. I mean, that could be kind of fun. It's like a dialogue. I can just live in your right speaker. Anyway, back to questions. You guys are flying with the questions. Keep them coming. There's a lot of questions on like stretch and hand reach.
Okay.
Do you have any specific exercise for improving the stretch and reach of your left hand? I really struggle with, for example, four string chords, like a minor nine.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So this kind of shape. Yep. Again, that is, and I'm not being mean when I say the word lack, but it is a lack of basic technique, and it's not a bad thing. It's just good that you've identified what the issue is and that you've got to work on it. So, maybe creating it, like, immediately I try and create an exercise for the problem. Like, if the issue is reaching out to that nine and probably having enough finger strength in the left hand to bar down to get that half step interval in the top to make your minor nine chord, D minor nine here, for instance, it's really about building up finger strength in the left hand. So I would probably arpeggiate that chord so you weren't working on the bar right away, but one, three, four, get that fourth finger out on the nine and skip up with the one to the minor third or the minor tenth up top. Now you see how my hand isn't moving left and right. It's not moving side to side. The only thing that's moving is the first finger. Everything else is staying in place. So it's not like I'm finding one note and then I got to search for the next one and then the shape changes for the next one and the next one. It's really about economy of movement. So just taking that shape. Now, obviously, the lower you get, the bigger that stretch is to make the minor nine. And anyway, chords don't sound so great once you start getting down. Like, I don't play this one too often, you know, minor nine voicing in A flat. And that's even a stretch for me down in G. So understand the range where it sounds good and then go after it super slow. And as soon as you start feeling a little pressure in the left hand or a little pain, stop and give yourself a break. If it's something that you haven't done before, you've got to take it easy.
That leads right into Wyatt Ware's question, which is, how do you practice the stretchy 5-fret span bar voicings to make them more comfortable?
Stretchy 5-fret span bar voicings. Okay. Bar voicings. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Gotcha. Okay, so this can be on a 4-string voicing, for instance. Let's do it on F sus. So I have an F. It's like an F13 sus. So F, D natural, E flat, and B flat. So this voicing, so you get this nice half step and a fifth. But down here with the bar that this person is asking about, with the F in the root. Again, maybe you want to really locate each note by arpeggiating it. And of course, the higher you go, the narrower that stretch is going to be, the less strenuous. So if I'm up here on A, for instance, which is probably the very upper limits of a regular 4-string. And
don't get it twisted. That is not an easy voicing for me to play. That's not somewhere I feel comfortable hanging out for. I'm kind of done after that. I want to go to something a little easier. So it's strenuous, kind of, no matter how long you've been playing. Some chord voicings are just tougher than others. And if you want to hang out on them a long time, you've got to work on them just that little bit longer.
Let's switch topics to your other hand.
Yeah.
Mark Griffiths asked, how do you build fluidity in your right hand?
Mm. As it pertains to chords or just in general?
I'm assuming chords.
I know. I was just creating a pause to have a drink.
Oh, wait. Before we move on to that, Leslie wants to know, can you name the notes and relationships of that 5-fret chord that you just played? That's a good question.
Notes and the relationships? Yeah, I just spelled them out. I said there was the root, if we're in F here, the 13, which is D, the flat 7, which is E flat, and the B flat, which is the 4 or the 11. That's what makes it suspended. And that, don't ignore the usefulness of this particular shape. Like, take away the root and remember and work on that shape. Because if, especially if you have a 5-string bass, you move it up a set of strings, put the same root note in, suddenly you have this beautiful minor 9 chord. So those are the notes and functions of that chord.
Cool. Right hand. Go.
So right hand, go. Well, when it comes to chords, it's the thing is, if we're talking about general, this doesn't really pertain to chords specifically, and we're talking about a general technique question. I can cover every single general technique question you have right now. If it is, what was the exact question? How do you work on fluidity in the right hand? Something like that.
Yeah, building fluidity.
Building fluidity. The same way you build fluidity in anything else, you use repetition. And you do it with the right intent, and you are hopefully doing it from a place of relaxation, from a place of calmness, not from frustration or anything like that. So no matter what the question is on technique and fluidity, it all comes from the same place, which is repetition and spending time with the instrument. It's the one thing most people don't want to hear as the answer, because it simply means hard work. That's it. There's nobody is super talented naturally to just have completely natural ability on the instrument without working on it. This is utter nonsense. Nobody has that. Anyone who you love to listen to, who you feel has beautiful technique and can express themselves on the instrument, at some point worked incredibly hard for a lot of hours. That whole 10,000 hours thing is way optimistic. Like, that's way under. So take that, maybe double it, and then you might get towards some serious fluidity. And of course, it's all about perspective as well. Like, how much are you really looking for? What do you really need out of it? There are different levels of it, and as long as you set realistic goals and realistic expectations of yourself, no problem to achieve them at all.
Cool. There's a lot of questions on creating chord voicings and like what your choices are, so let's start with this one, because it's good for the book. MJ Lewis asks, how do you approach chords from the top down using the melody note as a guide? I find myself always seeing chords from the bass note.
Mm, awesome.
Me too.
Okay. Well, I love seeing... See, the thing is, I always find my harmony. My ear tells me what's going on from the bass note, like the root motion. I'm sure you get that too, babe, right? When you're listening to things and you're ear training, it's like being bass players, it's so awesome that we get to identify the harmony, the basic fundamental harmony from the root note. But I always, I should probably find where that exercise is in the book, because I do have one specifically for reharmonizing. Where is it? Reharmonizing a melody note and just being aware of all of the options you have when you pick a note. And of course, where is it? Here we go. Reharmonization techniques. There it is. So on page 56 of the book, there's the 4-string version, which is basically having an ostinato. So you're talking about melody notes and going from the top down. So here's our top. We just have 2 melody notes. I haven't done this in so long. I'm going to cheat slightly here. Sorry, people. But basically, it's playing a chromatic bass line all the way. But basically, any bass note
works with any melody note. Let's just throw that out there right away. If I have C as my melody note, of course, C is the minor third of A minor, so beautiful, easy choice to make. It's also the major third of A flat. Okay, so there's a little crunchy chord, A flat augmented. It is the 9 of B flat, so that could go a number of different ways. That could go minor 9. It could go kind of a more, more dominant kind of sounding 9. So many different places it could go. It could go really hollow, like fifth voicing kind of 9. Now, of course, it's the flat 9 when you think of the root note as being B. So no reason why you can't have a B chord with a flat 9. Could also dress it up by changing the melody and putting the 13 in the top, but basically any melody note works with any bass note. So just with that, armed with that information alone, should give you complete free rein when it comes to finding chords. Now, it's then a question of building up that vocabulary, and which page 56 of the book, there's the exercise is number one, and then number two is filling in the notes in the chord and really creating some harmony. There's a 5-string version, which is exercise 3 and 4 on page 57. And it really just highlights how you can start off with a skeleton, like these two notes. Let's just take that. C is our melody note and A is our root note, and then start to fill in some inner harmony and see what we get. So we could have a really hollow sounding classical minor triad chord. This is one mood. If we just move the fifth up a half step, suddenly we get a major chord in the, couple of ways to think about this or hear this depending on the context. If we get a major chord in its first inversion, that would be F major first inversion. If we move it up another half step, we get this F sharp in the middle and we get a minor 6 sound, or potentially a diminished sound. Again, depends on context. If we move it up another half step, we get the flat 7. So we get this minor 7 chord. So right there, just having a root note and a melody note, and then 1, 2, 3, 4 different inner moving parts. In fact, if we move that inner part up a half step again, we get G sharp, we get the natural 7, we get a minor major sound. So you've got a hollow voicing with nothing in the middle, two notes, and then you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more voicings from just moving one inner part chromatically. So starting from there is an amazing place just to really increase your vocabulary of chords. Of course, trial and error is another way, just literally putting your fingers on the instrument and messing around until you find stuff you like. And I think most important for me in my development as a musician was transcription. And that's listening to people you love play harmony. For me, it was Herbie Hancock. It was Keith Jarrett. It still is those people. It was Chick Corea, who I saw a few weeks ago live, and just all of those memories of transcribing him from a kid came flooding back, and all those chord voicings. And it's really about assimilating that language as much as you can from the real masters of the music. You know what?
We have a lot of questions on extensions.
Oh, okay.
And for example, Van Rodriguez asks, how do you decide which notes to omit in a chord? Is it chord-based or shape and fingering-based?
Oh, it's sound-based. It's always musically based. It's never a technical thing.
And someone else relatedly asked, Matt McCormick, why do you so rarely use extensions and emphasize triads? I think that's false. I think you use extensions in shapes of triads, but they're actually the extension of the chord, right?
Sure. I mean, it's a multitude of things. So yeah, it's not that I don't use extensions. I do all the time, especially if you take a chord voicing like this. I've got 13 flat 9, flat 7. I had 13 natural 9, flat 7. So again, using inner moving parts. This one is not triad based, for instance. It's actually a major 7 voicing with the root a whole step up from that major 7. So E flat major 7, skeleton voicing, root third 7 with F in the bass, E flat G D with
F and the bass. It's a five string voicing. You could do that
and throw the F down there like that on a four string, no problem. But yeah, so, and yes, I do play triads. Because they're amazing, and but they also can give you, especially when you stack triads, a ton of different extensions on a chord. So let's see, let's go basic, let's go to a skeleton chord again, a really simple voicing. Let's go minor seven. This is like the I hate using the word dumb. Well, no, I don't. It's the dumbest voicing for a minor seven chord, short of this one. That's kind of muddy, but the kind of dumbest voicing for a minor seven chord that exists on the electric bass. But you're so close to being hip. That's what always amazes me about this one, because you're so close to being here, to having that half step, and having maybe the flat seven on top. And of course, you don't always have to play the root. Like, a lot of this stuff is obviously not that commonplace for electric bass players. This is not something that necessarily gets you hired for a gig, and it's something that will surely get you fired from a gig if it's overused. But as we're talking about it, and as it's something I do a lot, it's something very personal to me, there's a reason we're all here right now. Let's talk about the fact that you don't always have to have the root in the voicing, and you can be just playing extensions by playing these upper structure shapes. This one, for instance, giving you the 9, the 11, and the minor third, but it's all related to F. So if I'm comping for myself, and that all of these, you know, kind of close voice shapes with little crunchy half step and whole step intervals in them can all be extension finding. They can be coloring. You know, if you're looping, they're great to put something in the looper. Like, even if I just put a root note for now in the freeze pedal. So yeah, I definitely use extensions. It would take another few hours to explain all of them, but it's basically finding combinations of the extensions. The basic extensions being after the flat seven, when you get above the chord, being the 9, the 11, the 13, and then of course dominant chords, and you've got flat fives and diminished, all kinds of stuff. Extensions are extensions. They're not so much of a mystery. It's just about, I mean, I think the question was how you omit notes, right? How do you choose? It's tough, right? Because here we are, this bass, I have 5 strings. Woo! For the most part, people have 4. So it is tough. We don't have that guitar luxury or even the super luxury of the piano where we can voice lots of things. But like I said, right in the very beginning, that's why I wanted to start with the tenths. And how much harmony you can imply. Just 2 notes. So that when you do finally add a third note, nah, I shouldn't have gone with the sharp 5 there. But when you do finally add a third note, it's so impactful. So I like to delay the amount of time it takes to get to a full 5 note voicing and then really use that sparingly. And the more I can operate with 2 notes or 3 notes, the better. Okay, you're smiling and giggling over here. People are amusing you. I closed my chat over here so that I wouldn't do that.
I'm typing in Spanish to the
Spanish. Oh, now you're speaking here in Spanish. Yeah, okay.
Okay, we have a lot of good questions related to what we were just talking about.
Great.
And a lot of people are kind of circling around the same concept. So I think you're answering a lot of people's questions. I don't want people to think I'm not reading yours.
Sure.
We totally are, but he's kind of going through a lot of people's questions in one. But Keith Lewis asked the question in a way that is, again, kind of the same thing, but I appreciate this approach. He said, when playing melody with chords, I often have to sacrifice chord tones to have fingers available to move the melody around. Okay. How do you play a melody without losing the lush characteristics of a chord? And I think also, how do you choose which more staple voicings that you need to leave in?
Sure. I think again, it's all context, right? So I think it perhaps depends a little bit on where you are in the arrangement of the song. Like maybe if you're stating the melody of you know, that was playing All the Things You Are here, and I'm just using root and just basically using root and a few little inner moving parts. I'm not getting crazy. What I didn't do was start out with you know, with some like rootless cluster voicings to you know, to state the melody the very first time. Not that that isn't super hip and can be super hip, and it's not like, you know, a Bill Frisell hasn't done that super effectively and very sparsely and with, you know, I can't play like Bill Frisell. I wish I could, but there are so many ways to do it. But again, it comes down to having the basic technique and the basic vocabulary. Like, you should be able to play a song with the root note and the melody. Before you get into all that other stuff, before you get to the fancy stuff. So you should always have that, I don't want to call it a safety net, you should always just have that foundation of being able to play any melody with just the root note and the melody note. And to me, it's like, it's not necessarily that strong a melody if it doesn't make sense with just the root note and the melody note itself. I think that's a real indicator of a strong melody. Like, these are strong melodies that don't really need a lot of stuff going on underneath them. You know, you could literally walk a bass line and have a singer sing the song, and it would be that could be a completely full arrangement. So yeah, there are choices you have to make and notes you have to omit and things you have to sacrifice here and there when you're playing chord melodies on bass. But if you have the fundamentals of being able to play the song from top to bottom with a root note and a melody to fall back on, you should never, ever feel like there's a hole or like it's not complete. I hope that answered the question.
Yeah, definitely. And we've actually had a lot of people request that you play a standard or a ballad.
Oh, no, I knew that was going to happen.
And explain. Well, you just did it. You know two songs.
Wow.
I think you should.
Ladies and gentlemen, my ever critical, all-knowing, standard-knowing wife. Go on.
If you slow down a little bit and explain what you might do other than just playing roots, that would be helpful.
Well, here's an exercise that I stole from Tim Miller, which I think is super useful. We're getting into triads now. So if you do have the whole root note and melody note thing down and can play tenths, or any of that stuff, really important that you get through a song with triads, especially a song that has lots of changes, like All the Things You Are. It's a great exercise. So basically what you need to be in control of here is a triad in its root, first and second inversion. So let's, first chord of All the Things You Are is F minor. So just being able to play up F minor like this, and make sure you have a dominant or major control of a major triad. So the exercise is, you start off in the root position, you go up to the first inversion, and you play two shapes per chord. So F minor first inversion. Next chord is B flat minor, B flat minor. Now, if you go up, you go to the first inversion, and if you go down, you go to the second inversion. So I'll go up, down, up, up, down. And then it's tough when you've got two chords in the bar and you still want to make two voicings, but why not just play? We'll just play two chords there. And you can throw in, you know, when you start to get comfortable, don't just play straight triad on the major, play the sharp five. Add in little colors, but that's the basic premise of the exercise. Get through the whole tune in just triads. We're not talking about sevens, extensions, flat this, sharp the other freaking thing. We're just talking about basic 1, 3, 5 triads through a huge set of changes, like all the things you are. It's a challenge. And then can you do that in all 12 keys? You know, if that is a super stretch for you just to do it in the original key, I would suggest getting into basic major triads. Let's go just C. And do a cycle of fourths maybe, so F. Now, and be honest with yourself, is it that fluid? Is it as fluid as I just did it, or is it like, is it more like that? Okay, so this is just information, immediate feedback about where you're at with your technique and your vocabulary, how much you need to slow it down, how much more you need to work on certain things. It's not a bad thing if you suck at something. It's a great thing if you suck at something, because you are about to get immediately better at it. Gotta look at it like that. If you suck at something, you know exactly what you have to do. You have to slow it down, you have to work harder on it, and you will improve so much quicker than just perhaps telling yourself you don't suck at it. Mi amor.
Nice.
Próxima.
A real quick question.
Yes.
David Dove asks, would you explain skeleton and shell voicings? You do use that word a lot. Hmm. And what do you mean by it?
I mean, skeleton and shell. I'm not sure it's a technical term. Not that I also think I don't think I invented it or anything, but I think when I use that phrase, or if I think about what that means to me, it means simple. And it means basic, and it means just no extensions, no tensions. I'm a huge fan of it. If you've heard my song Erdnars, how does it go? And the root motion is. Even with this kind of crunchy chord here, it is a tension, yes, but it's a sharpened basic fundamental of the chord. It's just the sharp five. It's not a flat seven. It's not flat nine, sharp nine, sharp 11, flat. It is a flat 13, but it's in the context of a triad, so I think of it as a sharp five. And that whole thing is quite classical in nature, because these are all just 5-to-1 voicings. So G to C, G with the major third to C minor, E to A minor. I think of that as kind of skeleton or simple shell, I don't know. Without tensions, I guess, is how I feel it.
Okay, so related to that, mm-hmm. How would you approach voice leading and inversions?
Voice leading in inversions
and inversions
but and in inversions. Well, they're two different things. Inversions are what I've just been talking about, and in its most basic form here in the key of C, in with major triads. Basically, I'm not taking that triad where I play root, third, and then fifth on top. I'm taking the third and I'm putting it up an octave, so it's called a spread triad. So we get the root, the fifth, and the third becomes the tenth because it's up an octave. This is a spread triad. And then I'm just going up in inversions. So it's the root position. The first inversion is over the third. And the second inversion is over the fifth. And you go up the octave and you get the same voicing you had down here, but up an octave. Of course, you must be able to do this minor. All you're doing is switching the E for an E flat, all I'm doing is switching my tuning for something that's perhaps more in tune. All right, from the peanut gallery. Hardy ha. See, if you live with a bass player, this is what you live with. If you're married to a bass player, this is what you get. You get... Because they know. There's no way around it. It's like, oh, yeah, babe, that's fine. And she's like, no, that's not fine. So, yeah, try it. And then what was it? Voice leading?
Yeah. That's more what I was relating to what you were just doing with the classical technique. Like, what is your approach?
Okay. Sure. So that's a perfect example. Oh, okay. I wrote it, so I can't call it perfect. But it's a good example of how I feel voice leading, basically. So I don't like to have more than a minor third interval in the top voice when I move it. And what I mean by that is I don't like a big leap like this. I don't like that hugely. I like... So that was just moving up. So our melody... Basically moving up the major scale there, see? So kind of moving sequentially, no leaps of more than a minor third as a general rule of thumb. And, you know, with Erdnaz, it's more little, I think of it as smaller cells of voice leading. So this is a good voice leading. It's a half step going from D to E flat. And then the same cell happens again. And when it goes to the major, it's a whole step from G to A. So really close intervals in the melody, in the top of the voice when I'm voice leading. I guess that's my key there.
Got it. So Mikkel DeLuren asks, you often talk about not thinking about theory when playing.
Mm-hmm.
How much or little does this apply to your chord composing approach? I have a hard time not thinking diatonically when writing chord progressions.
Okay, so I think there's a multitude of things going on in that question. It's definitely not based or thought based when I'm playing live, when I'm improvising, and when I'm in the moment. I'm not thinking at all. I have a vocabulary of sounds and of options and possibilities and directions I can go, and some of the time I make it to those places. Some of the times I don't. And it's always a little more complex when you're moving chords around. But I think when I'm improvising with chords, it's also based so much around the melody. You know, if I think back on things I'm doing, you know, I have done live, and I'm just improvising there and moving around, and it's really about that melody. Obviously, the melody is one note, so it makes it super easy. But if I expand that, nope. See, if immediate fail right there. But I'm also totally okay with that, and I'm forcing it right this second for the purpose of making an example. I wouldn't force it when I was playing live. I'd let it happen, and I'd wait for that. See, I went minor there. But now the more I listen to it, that came way more naturally because I wasn't forcing it, and I just gave it a little more time. And you notice how it was only a few seconds more time before I decided, okay, actually maybe the major third leap is better there. So it's really based around the melody when I'm improvising and playing chords live. When I'm composing, perhaps there's a little more theory that comes into it, if only for orchestration purposes, and when I'm thinking about ranges of instruments and what sounds good in a viola that doesn't sound good in a violin, or where does the cello really sing out. Could you go and turn that off? Seriously,
I'm kind of stuck.
We've got a flashing light in here. Bulb is about to go. Yeah, so it's really about the circumstances, I guess, and the fact that, yeah, when I'm composing or when I'm arranging, it's, I have a lot more time to think. And you know, when I'm live, I'm not arranging for multiple instruments. I'm playing the bass, so it's, I guess, a lot easier in that sense. Yeah. Okay.
You keep talking. You're really asking a lot of me right now.
Okay. Our question master is returning to the throne. Who do we have up next?
We have a lot of questions that are kind of random, but I like them. So
okay,
we're
cool.
Just going to ask them in quick succession. Subschool 5 asks, are you a fan of Bill Evans' voicings?
Yeah, of course.
I assume that means, how do you apply it to the bass?
How do I apply it to the bass? Well, with great difficulty, actually. I mean, Bill, there's so many great things about it. To me, it was more... The things I get to apply to the bass from Bill Evans are more from like an arranging standpoint, and kind of all the sounds he created on Kind of Blue, and just so many things. The actual direct voicings, not so much, because we are quite limited. I can't stack a chord on top of another chord live. I can do that in the looper. I can put triads on top of each other. I can spread things out with bigger, like, series of fourth intervals and stuff like that. But with Bill, it's more about sound and about his concept of chord progressions. Yeah, that's what I take from Bill Evans.
Cool. Ben Kahn asks, do you have any voicings or exercises for moving chords through the bebop scale?
No. Next question.
Nice.
No. No, I mean, okay, I don't want to shit all over his question like that. I would first recommend like erasing the bebop scale from your vocabulary as a thing. Like, that's not a thing. Like, don't ever use that phrase. That's probably my best piece of advice to you. Sorry, I'm looking at Chelsea and not looking at the camera. Sorry, guys. Because if you want to play bebop, it's such a specific vocabulary and language from such a specific time, really from a specific very few players who really did it well. You know, like a dozen people maybe, who were the masters of it. So go transcribe that vocabulary, put it inside your playing if that's what you want. And then, yeah, reharmonize it, but I wouldn't refer to it as the bebop scale. Oh.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing. The gardeners are here blowing leaves outside the window. Awesome. Well, we shall soldier on. Go for it. Tell me.
Satyrus Christologulus
wow.
asks,
is that Greek?
I'm so sorry. Yeah, it's definitely Greek. And
okay.
I'm so sorry. Do you have any hacks to give that altered sound to a dominant chord without actually playing the altered?
No, another word you should erase from your vocabulary is hacks. There are no hacks. Please don't ever use that phrase.
Let's change it to tips. Do you have any tips?
Tips? Yeah, but no, but that's tips. Yeah, sure, but hacks? No, hacks is very specific, and I'm really passionate about that, because that is like 90% of the shit that is online right now. Is everyone wants to give you the one scale that you can use over every chord, or the five chords that you will only need to use for the rest of your life. It's bullshit. It's, you know, giving a chord an altered sound. Okay, let's do that. Is everyone aware of what the altered, if we take a dominant chord, the notes of an altered scale, so many different ways to think about it. A lot of people like to think about it as a melodic minor scale, a half step up from the root of the chord. So if you have G7 going to C, for instance, it's A flat melodic minor, but played from G to G. So it's the, what is it, the seventh mode of
melodic minor. That's exactly what it is. Yeah, sorry, I had to think of it. See, this is how little I think about that, although it's vocabulary I use literally every day that I play my instrument. So that right there is a massive goal in terms of, yes, it is a thing. There are probably 50 different ways of describing an altered scale or the altered sound and its function. But it's the same 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's the same 7, 8 notes, regardless of how you dress it up. It's still the same thing. And I think the only time you're really going to add that color to a chord or add that sound to your improvisation is if you have an understanding of where that fits. And to me, that is all about listening to, you know, John Coltrane use altered, or just listening to masters play 5-1 progressions, or just lots of dominant chords. You know, for me, it was Michael Brecker was the super master of that. Of course, he got a lot of stuff in train. So that lane is something I would recommend because that's what I did. But find your lane, find your spot that makes sense of assimilating that vocabulary.
Is it okay to put the tension of the chord at the bottom?
Oh, sure. Why not? I mean, it's a little tougher to convince an audience that sounds good, you know, on bass. That's more of an arranging thing. And, you know, here's the thing. What is the function of putting the tension at the bottom? And why, which tension are you picking, and why? There are so many things that go into that. You know, are you voicing a 7 chord? With perhaps the flat 9 in the bottom of the voicing? I have a whole exercise in the book on that. Let me just go to that page just so I can direct you guys. Is it towards the back? No, it's somewhere in there, or maybe it's in volume 2. Ooh. Okay, maybe it's in volume 2, but I have a whole thing about playing. Oh no, there we go. It's page 49, sharp 9 and slash chord exercise, page 49 in Chordal Harmony. There are voicings with like the flat 9 in the root, the sharp 9 in the root, flat 7. 5, just all different ways of voicing like rootless chords. To me, it's more of an arranging thing. I'll use that particular thing that I just played to create tension, perhaps if there's a vamp or something like that. But again, it's tough to make that convincing on the electric bass. So as much as I understand it, and I do use it sometimes on the bass, it's a little bit more of an arranging tool than it is a performance one.
Related question, John O'Keefe asks, when expanding a chordal composition from the bass to a band, can you speak on translating your voicings and inversions to the band?
Sure. I'm really picky. Let's see if I have an example of that right here, just on the last record. Yeah. So this is good example of something that happens. Is everyone hearing the audio there? Let's get some feedback on that. Are they hearing the music? No, it's a little bit of a delay, so we'll see. Okay, now those two chords right there, right? Okay, so that was the basic thing. But when the piano comes in, I was so specific about this has to be intense, for instance. I just wanted that no color other than it being a major triad. So when I'm just super specific when I give stuff to the band. There are places where I'm like, okay, this is basically all modal in C sharp. You do what you want. So I'm really conscious of that range of you know, and of course, who I'm writing for. That is super important. Is it someone who, like on this record, for instance, is Ruslan Sirota, who I play with all the time, and we know each other's playing inside out and know our kind of sensibilities and musical history. So I can put something in front of him and not have to explain it because I wrote it for him. And he's going to do exactly what I want with it, because we both hear kind of the same way. So it's a real delicate balance of what do you explain, and then what do you rely on the musician's ability to do a their thing, because you do, obviously you don't want to box them in too much as well. You know, you don't want to be the dictator. You want to get what you want, but you also want to give them the freedom. So it's quite a delicate balance, and I think the key is just working with good musicians, if that's an option. You know. And working with someone who really understands their instrument. Like, I understand the piano pretty well, but there are things Rusling can do, obviously, that I can't. And he will, you know, suggest things and say, oh, well, what about playing it in this register or something like that? So it's very much a give and take thing, and a delicate balance of explaining what it is you want.
Andre von Shears asks, can you give an example of using ghost notes in this chordal approach and notes that Charlie... face. And Charlie Hunter does this a lot.
Oh, he does? Says,
yeah.
Oh, well, if Charlie Hunter does it, I probably definitely can't do it. ghost notes. Ah, is he talking about
probably.
So is that maybe from a rhythmic standpoint? I'm not sure.
People are also asking how you incorporate rhythm to chords, so you could answer both of these questions.
Okay. All right. So let's go this lane. Here's a lane. Here is E lane. So yeah, I do all of those things actually. I know exactly what he's referencing when he talks about Charlie Hunter. I got it from Charlie Hunter. So there's an album called Disposable Heroes of Hypocrisy. What is the name of the song? Charlie Hunter plays on at least one track on that record, and that is where I got all of this stuff from. And it's from a palm muting standpoint. I'm just going to check my camera angle here so that you can see. Absolutely. So I have this palm muting thing. By the way, if you want to learn about palm muting, go check out Premier Guitar. Chelsea just wrote a dissertation on Pino Palladino and palm muting. I learned a lot. Okay, so... So there are these ghost notes going on, and they are dead notes. They're muted notes. So I'm muting with the left hand and continuing to rhythmically pluck with the right. So whoops, I should maybe play accurately. So it's basically there's a constant kind of constant pulse, potentially. It's not happening all the time because I'm not playing daka 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 throughout the whole thing. But there's essentially a down with the thumb and an up with the middle finger. Now you see how there was space there. I didn't go daka 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 through all the space, but I did pick a couple of them. I'm just kind of bullshitting harmonically here because I'm concentrating on the rhythmic side and the demonstration of that, but that's basically what it is: the down with the thumb, the up with the finger, and a kind of a potential constant pulse that at any point I can go grab one of those notes. And it's maybe from being a drummer before I was a bass player, understanding groove and how the four limbs work on a drum set to create a groove, something like that. I'm just trying to recreate that with my thumb and my middle finger in between, sparsely in between the chords that I'm playing.
Speaking of Charlie Hunter and people that you potentially stole things from,
that's everyone.
Ben Walker asks, there's two related questions. Do you take anything from other bass players, e.g. Patitucci, when it comes to applying chords on the bass? And Greg asks, how do you transcribe chords from musicians like Chick Corea and Herbie Hancock? How do you hear those chords?
Okay, so with John Patitucci, John's like the only bass solo I've ever transcribed, as far as I know. I don't count the Jaco stuff. That's a given, but anyone other than Jaco, John is the only one I've ever transcribed a bass solo from his album Mistura Fina, the track with Joe Bosco. I'm not sure if there's only one. Anyway, there's pretty evident, amazing bass solo there. As far as chordal playing from John goes, no, I don't think I've ever taken anything from John chordally. That is for no reason in particular. I love John's playing. I just never have never transcribed anything chordally from John. I don't think I've transcribed anything from a bass player chordally before either. I have to think about that. And then what was the other part of the question? The
how do you transcribe chords for bass for musicians like Chick Corea and Herbie Hancock?
So the thing is, like, don't let Chick Corea or Herbie Hancock or piano players in general freak you out, because they're still working from the same basic premise of what makes a chord, of what, you know, a root, a fifth, and a third. So you can, no matter how dense and how crazy a Herbie Hancock chord gets, you can normally identify whether it's minor, major, diminished, or augmented, like the basic foundation. Find the root note, find the melody note, and then start slotting in the pieces in between. And yeah, sometimes there are going to be six or seven pieces in between the bass note and the melody note. You just have to figure out which ones you like, which ones work well on the bass. There's no hard and fast rule as far as I'm concerned. I would just encourage you not to get freaked out by it being a piano player and there being, you know, seven or eight notes, because at the end of the day, somewhere in there, there's a root, a third, and a seventh, more than likely, on most kind of conventional or functional harmony. And then it's a question of really training your ear to figure that in, those inner parts out, and the voice leading stuff inside the parts. That's super important as well. That's something that all of those players that we've mentioned do so incredibly well, Herbie especially, with the inner moving parts, and something I paid super close attention to early on. And it's a question of starting simple. Like, I wouldn't start with Herbie Hancock if you're trying to, you know, transcribe piano chords. If you have some grasp of jazz, you know, maybe start out with like Red Garland or Oscar Peterson, or I don't know, like someone who's playing like really like thirds and sevenths a lot of the time, a little more old school, maybe 50s, 60s, Wynton Kelly, Red Garland, Victor Feldman, you know, those kind of players. Joe Zawinul is an awesome one, especially Joe Zawinul with Cannonball Adderley, like those kind of voicings if you're looking for jazz voicings from piano players. And then work up to Keith Jarrett and Chick Corea and, you know, modern day people like Brad Mehldau and Shai Maestro and those kind of people. And it's amazing how there's a little more of a classical twinge to like a Shai Maestro or Brad Mehldau or Aaron Parks a little bit, like those kind of players in the modern realm. So actually you start to get those skeleton and shell voicings with very sparse left hand and beautiful melodies. So yeah,
someone asked a million years ago, but it's related. Video okay. Bass Curse asked, have you ever incorporated ear training with playing chords on bass? If yes, how did you do it? And I only bring this question up because I'd like a more maybe elementary approach. Like, could you go through exactly how you might hear even a simple chord and then go, oh, this is exactly how I put that on a bass?
Yes, absolutely. And it goes to exactly what I was just saying about identifying the root and the third of a chord.
But then how do you make that voicing?
Absolutely. And that goes right back to the very first thing we talked about in this stream, which is our exercise of tenths. So if you're transcribing something and you've identified it and you're like, oh, that's B flat major, because it's maybe a blues in B flat or something. Okay. The first thing is, as a bass player, we're picking out root motions, I hope. So you've got the root, and if you can play this exercise, the very first exercise in chordal harmony, you should be able to play tenths up and down a major scale anywhere on the neck. So you immediately have available to you the tenth of that chord. Let's say it's a major chord. Okay? So basically you have the fundamentals of the chord right away, and maybe you're not aware of that, or you maybe you're not aware that it's that literally that simple, is to find the root motion. And then perhaps there's a melody note associated with the chord, and maybe it's this melody note, maybe it's this one. But it's literally that. It's finding that initial fundamental voicing, and then experimenting. Where is that melody note? And I used to have a cassette recorder, tape player, whatever. So I would just rewind and let it go. Rewind, let it go. Over and over and over and over again. And when you looked at the line of buttons on my cassette player, the rewind was like naturally half an inch lower than all the others, because that's the one I use the most. And it's just repetition, repetition, repetition when you were training your ear in the early stages, for sure.
New topic. Thibaut Tulp asks, really dig your solo and the melody, of course, on Erdnaz. Did you prepare some of that before going into the studio?
All of it. Oh, no, the solo or the... No, no, not the solo. The solo happened completely unprepared. It's not a bad one. If I had to pick out a solo that I was actually happy with from my entire recorded catalog, that might win. It made sense. I remember being relaxed and feeling really good about the music and feeling really good about being there with Peter Erskine and Alan Pasqua tracking that stuff. And very, very just focused day of tracking. And something I thought was going to take 2 days that took, we tracked the whole album in 4 hours. So it went by pretty quick and was super effective. So yeah, that was not something I prepared ahead of time at all. Only the compositions.
Got it. Bob Fowler would like to know if you could explain how you're getting the vibrato by pulling the bass the way you do.
Oh, okay. Just like that. If you're watching, you can see I'm using my third finger, 12th fret, G string. Going a whole step here. It's just like a wave. I like to think of it. See how I'm able to detune, flatten and sharpen the note. This is really extreme and really slow. But there's quite a range there without actually moving the finger. The finger is planted. And I'm applying pressure in either direction. That's super slow vibrato right there. And then, you know, a little more violin technique. Maybe lean into it with the fourth finger a little bit. And you can, of course, do that with an entire chord. And I'm doing that individually with each part of this chord, and sometimes it's in different directions because I hear the intonation is sometimes not perfect on certain chords, certain instruments, whatever. So I'm actually adjusting each note in sometimes in different directions. Sometimes I'm sharpening this note while flattening this note. That's I'm doing it, you know, really extreme now to make an example. See how you can chorus it almost, but I'm doing that in real time. That's just I think that's just an experience and touch thing, and it just depends on how crazy you are, number one, and how much you like to hear certain elements of chords in tune, like the temperament of that.
Neil Coleman asks, any tips for building out arrangement and instrumentation ideas from a bass-led chord progression when you don't have easy access to other musicians, as most of us don't right now?
Yeah, that's a tough one because you have to hear it in your head, unless you're MIDI sequencing it, which is almost worse than not hearing it, I think. you have to hear it in your head, and I think the only way I'm able to hear stuff in my head without the other musicians there is having done that before ever such a lot. So there's no real easy fix for that. You just have to do it. And obviously right now, nobody can do it. But yeah, always when it comes to arranging now, I'm trying to think simple. And simple is always more effective. And hiring great musicians, if that's possible, I always know they are going to bring something to the situation, whether I ask them to or not. It's something naturally original and unique is going to happen. So the less I color the information that I give them, the better, for the most part. Unless it's quite a thick, through-composed, very specific thing. You know, if I'm writing for strings or for horns or for a specifically orchestrated larger ensemble with less improvisation, then of course there are certain things, and that's again just experience, I believe, and knowing what works well in what range of each instrument that you're writing for. And I have a relationship with certain areas of my instrument that I think, oh, this is this area right here, though, that's kind of cello zone. And then I think, okay, up here is more violin zone, or like I have things, and tenor saxophone is sort of the entire range of the instrument. I equate things with my bass in particular, just because I've been listening to, transcribing, and writing for all those instruments for so long. So I think it comes down a lot to experience and a lot to listening and experimenting.
Ben Walker asks, can you discuss composing and working on chords through unrelated key centers? Do you have any favorite key center relationships?
Okay. That one. Don't roll your eyes at me, young woman. Yeah, I mean, they're so obvious. Minor thirds, right? Because, whoops, if I get this. So it's because it's so easy to sound like you're moving kind of way more than you are, or that you know way more than you do. So that was an early one. I try and stay away from that as much as possible now, but the minor thirds is a pretty obvious one to create big motion. Major chords in major thirds. That's another kind of obvious one. If I could do it. Etc. So the minor thirds, major thirds thing. For me, like that, it's melody driven. So I don't necessarily think about like, oh, I'm going to do this now, like this, like I want this sound. I don't normally sit down and write or compose from the standpoint of here we are in this zone. It's normally the melody dictating it, and then the myriad of options I have for reharmonization from the melody down, rather than the root motion up. That's generally how I look at it.
I'm caught off guard. I'm sorry. I'm so into this chat.
What is going on in this chat?
Nothing. People are asking good questions.
Uh-huh. How much Spanish are you speaking?
No Spanish. No Spanish at all. Okay. Also, what happened here? Sorry. Okay, let's ask this one. Yes. Austin Bolden asks, how do you balance cliche chord progressions and chord progressions that go out of key?
How do you balance them? Cliche, we talk literally. Are we talking like that kind of cliche? I'm not sure.
I would love to know how you put more color into simple, like 1-4-5 or 2-5-1, something to make it a little more artistic.
That's okay. That's a great.
Let me just augment this question.
Yeah, that's great. So let's take 1-4-5. Cheated a little bit there because I went outside 1-4-5, but going back to triad inversions is a great one, because we can move literally playing root position 1-4-5, and so basically the first two exercises in the book can basically give you this, but add the triads. You've got the suspension resolution. And then when you add a little bit of tension, maybe combine the triads, however you want to look at it. I was playing F in the first inversion, but I was adding the 9, which is just the fifth of C. And then I was adding the major 7, which is just the third of C. So
You could think of that as combined triads, or you could think of that as F major 7 over the third, but we're still not stepping outside. Of diatonic harmony, so you don't have to do much, I don't think, to create interest in it. Also, I love that one, the sharp five. I also love the diminished sound, so have diminished over the root. What is it? All those kind of sounds diminished back to one.
Lovely.
Lovely. Okay.
Simon Svensson asks, yes. Have you experience with six string basses or fives with a low B? Do you ever feel like you miss the low notes, an example for looping or grooving with a band?
No, I don't. There are times when I need it. A few months ago, I was doing a practice room episode and I played Chelsea's bass a bunch. That was fun. I was jamming along to some Usher. And, you know, if I was playing the gig with Usher, I'd probably play synth bass for the most part. But I'd probably play a five string with a low B. I have played it on tour before pretty extensively. And I don't miss it now at all. And I think the chords, as you can hear, sing out fantastically with a high C. That's probably 80% of the reason why I play a bass with a high C. Because you can do things like that. So no, I don't miss it. And I do have a little bit of experience with six string basses, but not very much at all. And I've never played one live. We will be getting one soon, our wedding bass. So I'll probably end up playing that quite a bit. Very really? Soon, Matheson, yeah. Okay, next question.
Are we going to 12?
Sorry?
Are we going to 12?
Actually, what time is it?
It's 11:35.
I'm getting exhausted. Let's do another 10 minutes and call it, because this has been super long.
Okay, why? Great. I'll ask a couple more questions, and then I have one I want to end on.
Okay, awesome. Great.
Or a couple to end on.
Yeah.
iNinja asks, any thoughts on incorporating inversions or slash chords into compositions? He generally conceptualizes them as chords with extensions.
Yeah, let the melody dictate.
Yeah.
You know, that's everything there. Let's take a quick melody. So. You know, just what does the melody tell you? And all of these options that you have. Actually, I really like that. Okay, guys, so we're taking a quick pause for the chorus here. Wow, okay, so I gotta work on that. Okay, cool. So, well, thank you for that question, because it really is just about that. I never played those chords in sequence, and I came up with this short melody, three notes, and then dictated. The melody dictated, you know, the music dictated what the chords are going to be. I don't think about slash chords, this chord, that chord. It's just, what does the music need? That's the first question. Speaking of questions.
I'm going to, three more.
So okay, cool. Three more.
Okay, so Nick Hasegawa asks, I would like to hear your take on how you apply these chords applied to bass lines and fills.
Okay, so using these chords to fill?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, the thing that made me fall in love with you was you using chords as a fill, actually, so you might as well.
Okay, newsflash, it's just in.
Wow. Okay. So we're finding out lots of things.
It was just your little like, you know, when you do the
do it, do it.
It's that. It's the six to the seven thing.
That. Guys, this is how you hook them.
It's not true.
No, like, I really hope it's not true. Does it matter the direction? Is it only descending?
Yeah. Wow. Only that exact lick. That's all. That's the only one. No, it's definitely not a minor song, not a major song.
Oh.
But you have to keep going. Yeah. There you go.
Okay.
Okay. No. That was not the deal. Go back or I quit. You're not paying me enough for this.
I'm paying you in cheesy chord licks.
You're paying me in nothing.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, this is like anything. You're going to play a fill. The space is there. The time is there. It has to be based around time and around sound and around content and concept and intent, like all those words are applicable here. You know, it's got to be directed and driven by the music before anything else. So I don't think it's important whether it's a chord or a linear idea. Yes, I do use tense, like we have discussed at great length today. So try moving those around. You find sequences that work, find melodic ideas on top of those, using the tenth as the melody, and find shapes and patterns that work and create tension and also release tension. You've got to be able to get back to home, get out and then get back to home.
Great. Más? Okay. Two more?
Dos más.
Chris Strait asked a very long time ago, could you go...
I hope you're still in the stream, Chris.
Could you show your go-to voicings when it comes to four-tone chords, especially the very jazzy ones? I think it'd be fun to finish this out by you kind of giving some cool ones.
Super cool ones. Super cool. I don't know if any of them are cool, but I mean, if you're talking... When people say jazzy, I guess they generally mean the crunchier ones, right? And... So, where is it? So the reason I'm playing this is Waltz in D-flat from my bass duo album with John Davis. The reason I'm playing that is to highlight how little I had to play until this chord. This super crunchy major chord. So again, don't get freaked out by it. It's a little weird, but it's underneath it all. It's just a major tenth. Guess what? It's just a major triad, spread triad with the natural fifth. The thing that makes it sound weird is I also have the sharp five. The five and the sharp five together, this half step, C and C sharp, encased with this root and tenth. It's not a fun stretch, but listen to what happens before. It's almost all two notes at a time. Three there. I play the crunchy one the first time. The second time, I just play. Because then we're moving on. Again, all just two notes. How effective is that? You hear and feel, more importantly, where the entire harmony is moving at all times. It is not rocket science. Mm-hmm.
notes. Very, very distinct. So, yes, I will definitely give you some crunchy voicings, this being one of them, being one of my favorite, actually, for four string. But I also want to highlight the fact that that is only really effective when you approach it in a certain way, I think. It's no good just having crunch, 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 crunch. It's just too much information. So, yes? You got another question?
Go ahead.
I've been working on this sequence of stuff lately. My buddy Gabriel Santiago kicked me in the ass with some major chords and diminished, and being able to reharmonize. Sorry. Just the major scale, going between major and diminished over major to major, diminished. And you can keep going up, actually, but these become five string voicings, and they're a little more of a stretch. Of course, that one, and then we go here probably. Yes, and then, but just. Just how to resolve diminished to major with the same root. So those are some nice crunchy voicings. And again, when we were talking earlier on about adding flavor to triads and diatonic harmony, that is another great way to do it. If we go back to our 1-4-5 thing, and then how diminished. Yeah. Mas?
We have our last question.
Ooh!
And I saved it.
Oh, no. Oh, you got that evil look.
No, I just like ending on a philosophical note.
Okay.
Paul C. asked quite a while ago. He's referencing you saying quite a few times that sucking at something's okay.
Yeah.
He says, do you think the internet has made people think they don't need to practice and will instantly be able to do something because of all the hacks, tips, and tricks content?
100%. I mean, yeah, we could. That's another 2 hours, right? That's another 2 weeks of talking about that. But yes, absolutely. I was talking with some friends about this the other day, about someone who is very well known, very famous, and very good. But none of us like this person in particular, and we were trying to be objective rather than subjective about it. And I ventured the opinion that perhaps, like, if we had seen Keith Jarrett or Herbie Hancock in their formative years, we're talking very formative, maybe we would have thought, oh yeah, they were sort of a arrogant sounding prick as well, and we wouldn't have dug it until it was time for us to hear what they had to say. And when they became Keith Jarrett and Herbie Hancock as we know them. And then my friends were like, well, hang on a second, those guys were playing on major records when they were 20 years old. So I maybe you got to really venture back into the early teens. But I think what social media is doing is putting all of that entire process on display, and nobody filters it out. Like, and it's very hard. It's very hard to put into words. It's like there's a lot of stuff that should stay private that doesn't, I think. And I think people, the viewing public, don't really know where to draw the line. Like, where is performance and where is somebody being an arrogant prick in their bedroom, for instance? Like, where is that line? Like, you wouldn't go pay money to see that, but it's a spectacle on the internet, so you'll watch it. And people, I think, will watch more of the spectacle than they will of the finished product, which dilutes the finished product and takes value from it in such a big way. And I think that's doing the artist a disservice. And I think it's dumbing down the audience, which is a shame. And I think for aspiring musicians, it's completely distorting what the reality of being a great musician is. And I think that completely throws off the process and does not promote working hard for long periods of time, which I think is the only way to do it. You know, I'm very, very firm on that. There are so many approaches and concepts within those confines of working hard. But I think if you don't work hard, you end up being,
insert at name on Instagram here, Shredder. You know what I mean? Like, just utterly pointless. Really pointless. Like, I don't understand it. And also now you're, of course, getting the image thing of, like, how do I look? What's my backdrop? You know, what instrument am I playing? What clothes am I wearing? How long did I let the 5 o'clock shadow grow out just to the right length to be this thing? It's got nothing to do with the music. So I think that's really important that people have that, you know, that veil pulled away and be like, oh, here's the reality. Like, you know, I don't think most people can tell the difference between a good musician and a dumb musician these days. I think that's the, you want to jump in here?
No, this is your masterclass.
No, I know, but it's always good to have.
We can re-answer this question on Two Bass Hit, and then I'll feel like it's my own platform.
There you go. That's actually
shout a out good... to Two Bass Hit.
Yeah, Two Bass Hit. That's our podcast that we do together. It's on the YouTube channel. Go check it out. What I haven't mentioned this entire masterclass, I don't think, is that the book is still 50% off. Today's the last day. No, I did in the beginning, I think. And plus, it's linked below. If you're watching this on YouTube, it is linked below. As far as I know, this video will be uploaded, if it's not already, to watch again on YouTube.
We also had a request to make Chordal Harmony 2 next month's book of the month.
Oh, really?
So that people can keep going. So, you know, just a thought.
We'll consider it. I had something else in mind, but maybe. Okay, we'll see. We'll see what happens. There's a lot going on next month, actually. We have a new book coming. We have the pentatonic book coming.
There were a lot of off-topic questions that I did not answer about how to use pentatonic scales, and I was excited to announce that our next book is actually exactly that.
Absolutely. And our next book, it will feature for the first time something that none of our books have, play-alongs. Which I'm really looking forward to. I'm doing them right now. So, just having musical examples and having a framework for you to practice those things with. Obviously, nothing beats going out and playing with other musicians and doing that in the real world. But the next best thing, I think, is to have that ability at home and have something that locks in with the book. Anyway, that's a different book. That's coming up next month. But for today, Chordal Harmony, Until Midnight Tonight, both physical at Amazon and digital on my store, are all 50% off. So if you don't have it already, go out and grab that. And thank you. Well, that's a great idea. That we should make the whole podcast about that Two Bass Hit, about online and
just ranting about people we hate. Nice.
Yeah, no. I want to be constructive about it. I don't want to say, it's all shit and there's no hope. I want to say, like, it's there and you should be very aware of how toxic it is if you're an aspiring musician and you actually want to work on the stuff that's going to provide you results, you know?
We should call it tips and hacks of how to stop using tips and hacks videos. Okay, your free 2 hours of moderator service are up now.
So okay, sorry, thank you, my love. And that's it. Let's say
bye, everyone. Thank you for listening. This was
you,
so fun,
Chelsea. And this was the first of what I hope many. I want to do these a little more regularly. Now I have this kind of setup. It will be a little slicker next time. But thank you, everyone, for hanging out. Really appreciate that. And we'll see you all again next time.